Hi, I'm Wintley Phipps, and welcome to World of Praise. Those sacred hours leading up to the crucifixion are filled with untold lessons to us. Among those lessons are, frankly, truths that are easy to miss. Today, allow me to bring one of them to your attention. Come with me back to the land of Palestine. Jesus was tired and sorrowful. He entered the Garden of Gethsemane knowing that there was a profound and important reason for his journey. Suddenly and without warning, Christ stopped and said to those three disciples who had come with him, "I must leave you here." Our Lord went on a little way ahead and fell on his knees. And with agony and tears, he began to pray like he had never prayed before. He began to pour out his soul to his Father. His great dread was the silence and separation from God that he would have to endure. Jesus knew that there is no suffering in life greater than a sense of separation from God. Separation from God was the cup of sorrow Christ had to now take to his lips. Separation from God was that dark and bitter cup that he now stared into at Gethsemane. There in the Garden of Gethsemane, that cup of woe trembled in his hand. For a moment, his humanity shrank from it, but in the end, he drank it. He stood up with the majesty of a king. The disciples had never seen Jesus glowing like this before. His face shone with the brightness of the noonday sun. As the sleeping disciples awakened from their sleep in amazement and fear, they gazed upon the bright, radiant form of their master. How he found the strength to speak lucidly and with compassion through his ordeal is perhaps one of the greatest miracles in the Bible. One writer said the cruel nails tore his flesh, the cutting words wounded his soul. As he hung dying a shameful death, he thought of all who had a part in his crucifixion. The Roman soldiers, yes, the fleeing disciples, the jeering mob, Pontius Pilate, Annas and Caiaphas. Jesus prayed for them all, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." I think the thing that had to be the hardest for him to bear was that even though he was a friend to all, in his time of need, all his friends forsook him. Where were they? The fishermen, the farmers, the tax collectors, the centurions, those who were shunned by society and who Jesus embraced as his friends. At times, even Jesus' own disciples were embarrassed by some of the people Jesus called his friends. Where were they? In the hour of his death, not one of his friends could be found. That day at Golgotha, irreverent men and women threatened to turn the most sacred moment in history into a sideshow. The soldiers at the cross bargaining for the robe of Jesus because his robe was woven in one piece. They found it impractical to divide it, and so instead, there at the foot of the cross, they gambled for it. Jesus was suspended upon the cross, it seems, accepted by neither earth nor heaven. The old familiar hymn says, "Dark was the night and cold the ground on which the Lord was laid. His sweat like drops of blood ran down in agony. He prayed, Father, remove this bitter cup, if such thy sacred will, if not content to drink it up, thy pleasure I fulfill." Go to the garden, sinner, see those precious drops that flow, for thee he did lie so low. Well, there on Calvary, suddenly at noon, a terrifying darkness blanketed the countryside, and an awesome silence settled upon that hill called Calvary. Fear became the dominant emotion around the cross. A loud cry pierced the still darkness like a sharp peal of thunder. It was Jesus crying out, overcome as it were by his frail, weak humanity. Of the seven last words spoken by Jesus at the cross, this word, what some call the fourth word, was the only word referenced and recorded by both Matthew and Mark. Of all that Jesus said at Calvary, Matthew and Mark seem to find this word bearing reference and record of note. They believe that it was important. When Jesus said, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? And I asked myself, why is that? Why is it that these two gospel writers found this word from Jesus so significant that they both recorded it? To them, there seemed something mysterious about this cry of anguish coming from the lips of the crucified Christ. Perhaps it was because throughout the life and ministry of Christ, there was always in his words and actions a kind of rock-solid assurance that God the Father was with him. Perhaps it was because no evil thrown against him before was ever able to pierce that shield of confidence that his Father was with him. Abundant are the examples of this sure conviction in the life of Jesus, but none more compelling than the incidents of treachery in Gethsemane. You remember, by covering of night, Judas had been negotiating with the enemies of Jesus. The bounty of silver that would rest upon his head was made. Obviously, Judas wanted Jesus taken more than his enemies thought that the whole thing was worth, because they settled on only 30 pieces of silver for Judas to hand over Jesus. And from the very beginning of their working relationship, Jesus knew that the possibility of treachery lurked in the heart of Jesus. But if he knew it, why would he allow the association to develop into a working relationship? You know, one of the things I love about my Lord is that in the pursuit of my heart, he is not dissuaded by my reticence, neither is he turned back by my cool response to his warm overtures. Hallelujah. He is not discouraged even by my own treachery. Like Judas, he trusts me when in my heart he knows I am not worthy of such trust. He is not guided by what he knows I'm capable of if I'm left to my own devices. Someone said Christ came into the world precisely because there are Judases in the world. He came into the world because there are some of us who have it in our hearts to be Judases. Not once did we hear from Jesus a discouraging word towards Judas. Instead, all we saw was the master clinging to that outside chance that Judas would come to his senses. Jesus always operated under an assumption of hope that love and care shown towards Judas would result in the changing of his heart and the turning away from the dark paths upon which he had entered. And so even until the very end, Christ washed the feet of Judas. Even though he knew Judas was cutting a deal with the priests, at his final meal with his disciples, Judas was welcomed. Now, if you knew someone was seeking to betray you, would you, knowing the hour of that betrayal just before it happened, break bread with them? You see, for Jesus, sharing that meal with Judas was one last gesture of peace and love. Jesus was saying to Judas, Judas, even though I know all that you are seeking to do and planning to do, still I stretch out my hand to you and offer you a token of my friendship. The Bible says, and while he yet spake, lo, Judas, one of the 12, came, and with him a great multitude with swords and staffs from the chief priests and elders of the people. Now he that betrayed him gave them a sign, saying, whosoever I shall kiss, that same is he. Hold him fast. And forthwith he came to Jesus and said, Hail, Master, and kissed him. And Jesus said unto him, Friend, wherefore art thou come? Then came they and laid hands on Jesus and took him. Anyone who has been ever hurt by a friend will know to some extent how Jesus must have felt. The betrayal of Judas caused our Savior inexpressible sorrow. You see, if an enemy spreads false rumors about you, you may become understandably angry. But when a so-called friend does it, that's another matter. Imagine how Jesus must have felt when Judas kissed him. Our Lord had lavished all this love on this very selfish disciple. The other disciples had recommended Judas. 3 years Judas spent in close fellowship with Jesus. Judas saw his miracles, listened to his sermons. Judas saw things that would convict any sane human being that this man was the Son of God. Imagine how Jesus must have felt looking into the guilty eyes of Judas when he said, "Friend, wherefore art thou come? Judas, betrayest thou the Son of Man with a kiss?" Someone once said, an enemy can never make himself guilty of treason. Let me let you in on something. When you offer your enemy your love and friendship, your enemy's heart will either grow warm towards you or grow darker and colder. You see, later when Jesus lay dying between the two thieves, his presence softened the heart of one thief, but it hardened the heart of the other. His presence brought forth from one cursing, while it brought forth from the other a prayer, "Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom." Judas dined with Jesus and then went out in treachery to have his final meeting with those who were paying him to betray Jesus. They agreed on who would come, when they would come, where and how they would take him into their custody. They would take him prisoner in the garden, his favorite place of prayer. They would take him under cover of darkness, lest they agitate the masses who loved him. Jesus knew that his hour had come, and that night he would face treachery and cruelty. He knew that the steps of his betrayer were even now encroaching upon his slumbering disciples, so that his enemies would not find them sleeping. Jesus woke them. His enemies decided on a contingent of the temple guard, along with servants of the priests. They were armed with knives and small swords. They requested of Pilate a group of his best garrison soldiers. Everything was ready. The only thing left to decide upon was the signal by Judas which one was indeed Jesus, lest some courageous disciple decided to be taken in the place of Jesus. In the murky shadows of the Olive Garden, it would be easy for the soldiers to arrest the wrong man. And so Judas decided upon the sign, "Whosoever I shall kiss, the same is he. Take him and lead him away." You know, when Judas left that upper room, he went away really a demon-possessed man, because only a demon would betray a friend with a kiss. Only a demon would seal an act of treachery with an act of affection. "Judas, dost thou betray me with a kiss?" said Jesus. You would seal your damnation with a gesture of your affection, and that your lips would seal your doom? One writer said, right then and there, those 30 pieces of silver blistered the hands of Judas. Immediately, he returned to those who had paid him, trying to undo what he had done, but it was too late. In the end, Judas was so overcome by shame that he took his own life. And now that name, Judas, has become the name for everything that is treacherous in the human heart. In Dante's great poem, when the pilgrim of the other world reaches to the last post of hell, there in the middle of the frozen ice, he finds Lucifer, the ultimate spirit of evil, and in the central mouth of his three loathsome mouths, he sees the body of Judas Iscariot half devoured. Over and over again, it is forbidden. It was forbidden by the church in the early days that a child should be baptized by the name of Jude or Judas. In all of this, I don't want you to miss one important detail. The last time Jesus spoke to those three disciples in the garden, he said to them, "You can sleep now, for it's all over. The betrayal is complete, and the authorities are already in the garden looking for me." But the disciples didn't hear him. And Matthew 26, 46 says, "Then he woke them and said, 'Come, get up. My betrayer is here with the priest and the temple guards to arrest me. Let's go to meet them.'" In verse 47 of Matthew 26, "By the time Jesus got the three disciples to their feet, Judas had found them and had come over to where they were. Following Judas came the priests, elders, temple guards, and a mob carrying knives and clubs. True to his word, Judas walked up to Jesus and said, 'Hello, master,' and then kissed him. Jesus said, 'Friend, why have you come?' Then Judas stepped back, and the temple guards grabbed Jesus and held him tightly. When Peter saw this, he became enraged. He pulled his sword from his belt, swung it at the high priest's servant. The young man saw the blade coming and turned his head just in time, but Peter's sword clipped off his ear. Then Jesus turned to Peter and said, 'Put your sword away. Anyone who makes his way by fighting will die fighting. I could have asked my father for 12 armies of angels, and they would have gladly come to help me. Thinkest thou not that I cannot now pray to my father, and he shall presently give me more than 12 legions of angels? But how then shall the scriptures be fulfilled, that thus it must be?' In that same hour," the Bible said, "Jesus said to the multitudes, 'Are you come out against a thief with swords and staffs for to take me? I sat daily with you teaching in the temple, and ye laid no hold on me.'" Just hours before his death on Calvary, here Jesus was standing on the sure ground of confidence that no matter what they threw at him, he knew his Father was with him. He said, "I could have asked my Father for 12 armies of angels, and they would have gladly come to help me. Thinkest thou that I cannot now pray to my Father, and he will give me more than 12 legions of angels? But all this was done that the scriptures of the prophets might be fulfilled." After restoring the wounded man's ear, Jesus turned to the priest and said, "Why did you come out here with swords and clubs as if I were a common criminal? I sat with you in the temple teaching the people. Why didn't you arrest me then? Yet it has to happen this way, in order for the prophecies to be fulfilled." Then Peter and all the disciples fled, just as Jesus had said they would. Someone said all Judas was an average man with a special weakness. You see, Judas's problem was that he never let Jesus deal with his weakness. For 3 years, 3 years, day after day, day after day, Judas lived and worked and traveled with Jesus, yet he never let Jesus deal with his weakness. In Gethsemane, Christ saw the cross. He could hear the angry mob calling for his crucifixion. He saw God the Father, with whom he had coexisted from all eternity, seemingly turn his back on him and look no more on him until he drank from the bitter cup. He realized what it meant to be smitten of God and afflicted. As Isaiah had said, there in the shadows of that cruel cross, finally the confidence Jesus nurtured all his life, that his Father was always with him. There on Calvary, Jesus was eventually crying out, "Father, I know you've been with me, but why now do you forsake me?" Never, never in his 33 years had Jesus ever doubted the unwavering presence and support of his Father. Even in Gethsemane, Jesus knew what it meant to be lonely and alone. He knew that the judgment and penalty for sin was and always will be eternal separation from God. In the garden, though Jesus was standing in a different attitude from that which he had stood before, in the wilderness of temptation, Jesus knew his Father was with him. Throughout his ministry, Jesus knew his Father was with him. Standing outside Lazarus' tomb, Jesus knew his Father was with him. But on Golgotha, with hell and all of its fury waiting for Jesus, all eternity had been one with the Father, and now because of the sin he carried for us, he felt under condemnation by his Father. His soul was filled with dread of being separated, even for one moment, from his Father. Christ knew that being one with the sinner in his sins would separate him from his Father, and this shook the most basic, fundamental belief that anchored Jesus throughout his life. The Father is with me. And that's why the agony of the cross was manifest in that mysterious cry, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? The wrath that the Father had reserved for us was poured out upon his sinless Son. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we were healed. There have been times in my life when I prayed and no comfort seemed to come. And all I could do was cling to the confidence that I was not alone and that God was with me. There have been times when it seemed like I didn't have the strength to climb the mountain before me. Times when I felt like I didn't have a friend, but I clung to the confidence that I was not alone and that God was with me. Someone said, never alone, never alone. He promised never to leave me, never to leave me alone. And so through every dark valley, you are not alone. Wounded by friends and scarred by enemies, cling to this confidence that God is with you and you are never alone. In times of trouble, this faith will calm your anxious spirit. It will steady your staggering soul. You are not alone because the Father is with you. There have been days when I've known that I've heard God whisper to me, be not dismayed, for I am with you. Be not discouraged, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with the right hand of my righteousness. When you pass through the rivers, they will not sweep over you. When you walk through the fire, you will not be burned, for I, the Lord, will be with you. And yea, though you walk through the valley of the shadow of death, you will fear no evil, for I, the Lord, am with you. So no matter what happens in your life, the Lord of hosts is with you. No matter what happens in your life, the God of Jacob is with you, and you are not alone. I'm Wintley Phipps. You go out today and make your world a world of praise. Would you like to help us build a media center for evangelism? A worship center that is also a television studio? God has blessed us with this prime piece of property here at the Palm Bay Church in Florida. From this place, we want to broadcast this message and this gospel all around the world. If you feel like God is leading you to help us, please write us at World of Praise,
P.O. Box 8008, Vero Beach, Florida, 32964. Or you can call us at 618-627-4651.
In the sands, in the sands, got the world in the sands.
In the sands, in the sands,
got got the world in his hand.
He's got the whole world in his hands. 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 He's got the wind and the rain in his hands. He's got the wind and the rain in his hands. He's got the wind and the rain. He's got the whole world in his hands. He's got the little bitty baby in his hands. He's got the little bitty baby in his hands. He's got the little bitty baby in his hands. He's got the whole world in his hands. He's got you and me, brother. In his hands, he's got you and me, sister. In his hands, he's got you and me, brother. In his hands, he's got the whole world in his hands. He's got everybody here. In his hands, he's got everybody here. In his hands, he's got everybody here. In his hands, he's got the whole.